أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، سيدي وحبيبي ونور قلبي، وثمرة فؤادي أبا القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الهاديين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
قال الله النبي في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها، قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها. صدق الله العلي العظيم.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
إن شاء الله، tonight our topic is about al-jihad. You know, this is one of the hot topics in the world of today. When we hear the word jihad, what comes in mind is different. For that matter, I wanted to discuss about what is jihad in Islamic point of view. But before we go to talk about al-jihad in Islam, let's take a look at this verse that we just read in Surah Al-Shams. This surah is unique in its own way. And the reason why this surah is unique, because it's the only surah in the Quran Allah presented the most of the swear words. When you take the Quran, and so many places Allah presented many swear words, but not as much as in Surah Al-Shams. And one of the other important things about this surah is that anytime you take a Quran or a surah or a verse and you see that Allah started with a swearing, there are two things to learn. Anytime in a surah or a verse you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started the ayah or a verse with the swearing, there are always two things to remember. Number one, whatever Allah swears by in that surah, Allah wants to tell you that particular thing is important. That's something to keep in mind. Because Allah will not swear by something that is not important. So anytime you see in the Quran, Allah swears by something, you have to keep in mind that that particular thing is important in the sight of Allah. That is one. Number two, after the swearing, what is it that Allah wants to talk about? That also tells you about the importance of what Allah wants to address. Now, in all the surahs or all the Quran, Allah never presented most of the swears as in this surah. Sometimes it presents one swear. Example, wal asr, I swear by the tongue. Sometimes he presents two, wal duha. والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى. Sometimes three times. والتين والزيتون وتور سينين وهذا البلد الأمين. But Allah never presented so many swearings in one surah as this surah. Now, come to the surah and see. Allah said, والشمس وضحاها. The waw there, which is the beginning of the surah, is called in Arabic waw al-qasam, the waw of swearing. Because in Arabic, there are three letters you can use to swear. And they call them in Arabic حروف القسم. The first one is wow. You said wallah, right? When you swear wal Hussein, for example, right? When you swear, you say wa. That wa is called حرف القسم. The second letter you can use to swear is ba, billah, right? Bil Hussein, for example. Also, you can swear. That is two. Number three is called the letter ta. You say tallah, right? Now, all these three letters you can use to swear. But most of the time, Allah used the word wa, the letter wa. Like he used in this surah, Allah said, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا. I swear, and he swear by two things in one ayah. Just one ayah, two swears. One is وَالشَّمْسِ. I swear by the sun. Number two, وَضُحَاهَا. And I swear by the light that comes with the sun. Allahu Akbar. And remember we said, anytime Allah swear by something, there is an indication that that particular thing he swore by is important. Now the question, what is the importance of sun? That out of the creation, Allah in this surah, he started with the swearing by the sun. وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا. I swear by the sun, one, two, and I swear by the light that comes with the sun. Now there is no time to go into details about the benefit of sun in our life, right? But I'm just going to give you some key points. Number one, the sun plays a big role in our life. So much that most of the time we don't even think. But if we are to think and reflect about the importance of sun, we will always thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that blessing. Right? Now forget about anything. The benefit of sun in your life, in my life. What is it? The sun, even if it doesn't do anything in your life, is one of the source of your vitamin D. You know that? Just walking under the sun. Just walking, not doing anything, right? You get vitamin. It gives you vitamin. And which vitamin? D. Now, if you walk to Walmart to buy vitamin D, can you take it free? No. The first thing they're going to call 911. Because you are shoplifting. So I want vitamin D. So yes, you have to pay for it. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the sun. You're walking on the street without doing anything, and the sun gives you what? Vitamin D. How much? Free of charge. But then we don't dare to say, Allah, thank you for this blessing. Right? That is one, the benefit of sun. Number two, your food that you eat, if Allah didn't create a sun, you will not have a food to eat. Every plant that we get from the, well, every plant, a farmer plant, it depends on the sun. No sun, no food. Right? Now you come home and there is no food at home. You're hungry. What happens to the husbands, right? You come home, you call honey. I'm coming home. Inshallah, make sure that food is ready, right? You walk inside the house. You said, honey, where's my food? Say, no food. Allahu Akbar. Your face is going to change, right? Your mood is going to change. What? No food. But you never stop to think. Allah created the sun, and the sun is one of the way your food gets ready. Why? Now, you take any plant, you put it under and the downstairs or somewhere locked where the plant doesn't get sun. What happened to the sun? What happened to the plant? It does. Cannot survive without the sun. Right? So your food that you eat, a sun also plays a big role in that as well. And that is one of the significance of the sun. And that is why Allah said, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا. I swear by the sun, which plays two roles. At least one is in you as a human being, two, and the things outside and your surrounding as well. Right? That is one. وَضُحَاهَا. I swear by the light that comes with the sun. You know the benefit of the duha? And Allah swear by it also in another surah. وَضُحَا. I swear by the morning light that comes with the sun. Why? Because it's a big thing. Why? Because the duha, the light that comes with the sun, it comes with the light to give you the chance to see things differently. That is duha. Number two, sometimes it's the reason for you to wake up. Right? If your bed is next to the door, next to the window, right? And the window, the sun started reflecting to the window, what happened? It helps you to wake up free of charge.
Sometimes if you don't have alarm, the sun wakes you up.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you, وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا. I swear by the sun and I swear by the light that comes with it. Two of them.
Then Allah goes to the next one. وَالْقَمَرْ إِذَا تَلَاهَا. I swear by the moon which follows the sun.
Why? A moon also plays a big role in our life. Right? Number one, the moon is the source of our calculation of the month. Right? Now you say, I am 30 years old, I'm 40 years old, I'm 10, I'm 5, right? How do you calculate your day?
By the moon.
Right?
Allah said, I swear by the moon because it plays a big role in your life.
Number two, another importance of the moon is that it's a source of the light as well. Maybe in the West we don't understand how much the moon plays a big role in our life,
but you go to the poorest countries. Right? In Africa, in other part of the world, you know how much moon plays a role in their life?
A lot of gatherings that people do in some part of the Africa, they base until the moon comes on the 13th and 14th and 15th. Right?
When the moon is more brighter and shiner, so they can see to do their gatherings. Because they can't afford this electricity that we have.
Right? And if they want to do something important, they always ascribe it to her
to that time. And because the moon is very important in their lives.
Right? That's why Allah said, I swear by the moon, وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا, which follows
the sun. And here Allah wants to tell there is a system he created.
What is the system? The system is that Allah created the sun, and the sun comes first, and the moon follows. There is a routine between the two. And that's why the next ayah is Wal-Qamar, I swear by the moon, when it follows. Follows means there is someone who's leader and there is someone who's a follower.
And this was a system Allah created,
right?
But we think it's just happened, right? They just live their own life. No, no, Allah tells us it's a system we created.
Wal-Qamar is a talah. Then Allah said, Wal-Nahar. I swear by the day, right?
وَالنَّهَارُ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا, which comes to uncover the darkness of the night. And amazing. You know the benefit of the day?
The day that we have. How many of us ever stop at one point and thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us a day?
We don't appreciate Allah's blessings. But you know, Allah tells us that everything he created has a benefit for it.
Now the day, what is the benefit of it? You go to the Quran, in Surah An-Naba, Allah said, we created a day so you and I can have our
daily bread through that. وَجَعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَاشًا.
We created a day for daily bread. Right? Now you look at the animals, even the birds, right? Early in the morning, you see them, they're flying from their nest.
Where are they going? They're going to search for their daily bread. Allahu Akbar.
Now, who taught them? Birds. Who taught you that the day is the time to go and search for bread?
They already know by the system of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Because Allah created the system that a day is the time to go and search for daily bread.
But you know who is the one who mixed up this creation of Allah? Human being. Allah said the day is for daily bread. Some of us, the day is for what? For sleeping.
And what is for night?
The night is for daily bread.
The day that they're supposed to go and search and work and earn their halal income? No, that is the time they sleep.
But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَجَعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَاشًا.
The day is that supposed to be a time of searching for the daily bread.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالنَّهَارُ إِذَا جَلَّاهَا. Then Allah says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا. I swear by the night, which comes also to cover the light of the sun. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا نَايْتُ. You know, night also is another blessing Allah created.
The night is a time Allah created. And one of the benefits of night, Allah said it in another surah, He said, we created a night
for your resting. Allahu Akbar. وَجَعَلْنَا نَوْمَكُمْ سُبَاتًا.
The night is the time to supposed to rest. Even animals, in the morning you see them, they're flying, searching for bird, searching for food. But in the evening, what do? You see them, they're flying back. Where are they going? They are going back to their nest to go and rest so they can get their energy ready for the next day. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us. وَجَعَلْنَا النَّهَارَ مَعَشًا وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ لِبَاسًا. Here Allah said, we created a night also for that purpose. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَخْشَى. Then Allah said, وَالسَّمَاءِ وَمَا بَنَاهُ. I swear by the heavens. Allahu Akbar. What is the heaven? And the benefit of the heaven. One of the most important things that our life depends on, it comes from the heaven. And what is it? As the water we drink. And Allah said in Surah An-Naba, وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُقْصِرَاتِ مَاءً فَجَّرْنَا. Allah said, we send the rain down. And the rain, where does it come? It comes from the heavens. For you to live on and drink the delicious water. Right? And these are all come from where? From the heavens. Now, Allah said, وَالسَّمَاءُ وَمَا بَنَاهُ. I swear by the heavens and the power that created the heavens. And you know, this is the only surah where Allah swears with everything, including himself. Some of the surahs, Allah swears by other things. He doesn't include himself. But in this surah, Allah added himself into it. Where he says, I swear by the heavens and the power that created the heavens. Now, which power created the heavens? His power. He is the creator. No, but in the ayah it says, I swear not just by the heavens, with the power that created heaven. Now, Allahu Akbar. What is the power that created the heaven? Now, here, listen. Allahu Akbar. See, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, I swear by the heavens, because heavens is one of the miracles we need to reflect. How? Now, you look, for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, we created the heavens, and doesn't need any pillar to hold the heavens. Right? The heavens is created and it doesn't need anything to hold it. But then Allah comes to the next ayah. وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا طَحَاهَا. I swear by the earth. This earth, Allah says, I swear by it. وَمَا طَحَاهَا. And the power that stretches the earth. Right? Allah says, I swear by the earth. And وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا earth. This earth is full of our blessings. Everything we need, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes sure that it's on this earth. Number one, our creation. Allah created us from where? From this earth. Right? Number two, where do we go after we die? We go back to the earth. Number three, where would Allah take us out for the day of judgment? From the same earth. The food we eat, where does it come from? From the earth. The houses we live in, where does it come? From the earth. Every need of human being, Allah made sure that it's on this earth. Right? And that is the importance of the earth. وَالْأَرْضَ وَمَا طَحَاهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا. The next word, and Allah said, I swear by the nafs. Nafs means what? The soul. وَمَا سَوَّاهَا. And the power that sway the heart, the soul. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything. And after he created it, Allah said, we guide it and we show it the right path. Nothing in this world, Allah created and left it without guidance. No, everything. That's why Musa alayhi salam, when he went to Fir'aun, and Fir'aun asked him, who is your Lord that you're talking about, Fir'aun? قَالَ مَا رَبُّكُمَا يَا مُوسَى. قال ربنا الذي أعطى كل شيء خلقه ثم هدى. الله أكبر. Moses respond, is that you want to know my Lord? Is the one who created everything and guided it. Everything Allah creates, he guides it. الله أكبر. Now even sometime beyond you and I, our imagination. Now the blood which flows to your heart, do you have any control over it? No. The cells in your blood, do you have any control over it? No. The beating of your heart, do you have any control over it? No. But Allah systemized it that they work according to the teaching of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's your body, but you have no control over it. Right? Now all this system, Allah created it because of a reason. And they work under the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if one of them, one of the cells, they start producing, it becomes a major issue in your life. Allahu Akbar. One cell, they start producing or they start working properly, it becomes a bigger issue in your system. But we never stop to think about that system that Allah created in us. That is why Imam Ali said in Najil Balagha, أَتَسْأُمُ أَنَّكَ جُرْمٌ صَغِيرٌ. You think you're a small creature? وَفِيكَ انْتَوَى الْعَالَمُ. Right? And there is a world Allah created in your system. That is nafs. Now, Allah said, وَنَفْسٍ وَمَا سَوَّاهَا. I swear by the nafs, and Allah that guides that nafs towards the right path. And Allah said, when we created the nafs, we inspired it with two powers. Every nafs has two powers. One power, I said, فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا. We inspired it with corruption. Shaitan can corrupt it and make it the bad and make it worse. And Allah also inspired it with wa. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَى. It can also be muttaqi. God word. Good. Which means it was given two powers. One power is to take him to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the other power is to take it down, which is by shaitan. That's a two struggle in a human being. One struggle to take you to Allah, one struggle to take you down. And that's what Allah said. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَى. And I said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَى. Whoever is able to purify that soul and make it clean and make it surrender to Allah, Allah said, indeed, he's the most successful person. And here, you know, we have different understanding. Who do we call a successful person now, today, in our life? A person who makes more money, right? A person who makes more money, he's successful. We respect them, we honor them. Right? We glorify them because they have almighty dollars. Right? They are now respectful because of that. Now, a person who doesn't have anything, but he has fear of Allah, is nothing in our society. Nobody respects them. Nobody listens to them. When they come in the gatherings, they sit next to the door. Right? If a wealthy man comes in, mashallah, we all stand up. We make sure that he gets sit comfortable. We can make sure everything is taken care of for him. Or for her, because they have money. But the measure of Allah is completely different. In this surah, Allah says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَى. Allah says, you want to know who's successful to me? Not about money. No. Who is it? The person who is able to purify their soul. Is able to take care of themselves. And here, think about it, brothers. A person who is able to take care of so many things around them, but fail to take care of the smallest thing in their body, versus a person who is able to take care of the smallest thing in their body, right? Even though they cannot take care of other things, who is he deserve to be respected? Right? The smallest thing in your body, your heart, your soul, I'm not able to take care of it. Right? But I'm able to take care of things around me. But then we respect the person. And the person who's able to take care of his soul. Right? Which the prophet said, that small piece of me, if it's like the driver in the human being. If it's pure and clean, as everything becomes pure. Because this soul, if it's pure, Allah, your sight becomes pure. Your hearing becomes pure. Your mouth becomes pure. Your legs become pure. Everything in your life becomes pure. But if this heart and soul is not pure, nothing becomes pure around you. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Whoever is not able to take care of this soul and purify it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فقد خاب من دساه. That person, Allah سبحانه وتعالى calls him a loser. Even if he owned the entire world, he's a loser in the sight of Allah. He is the wealthiest person, he's a loser. He has everything in this world, Allah says he's a loser. Why? Because he fails to take care of the smallest thing in his own body, which is his soul. His soul. Right? So Allah said, وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّهَا. Now, up to here, I just want you to understand the ayah, and I'm going to enter to the topic of jihad that we're talking about. Because in Quran, purification of soul is called tazkiyatun nafs, purification of soul, right? But in hadith, it's not called tazkiyatun nafs. In hadith, it's called al-jihad. Now, what's the meaning of jihad? The word jihad, literally in Arabic, it means struggle. Any kind of struggle is called jihad. I'm struggling to open somebody's door, to break somebody's house, it's called jihad. What? Somebody's house, I'm breaking, it's called jihad. I'm struggling to do anything, whether it's good or bad, it's called jihad in Arabic. And that is why we call our maraja mujtahid, from the word jihad, because they struggle to come up with the Islamic ruling. And that's one of the reasons today we don't respect them. We think Marja is sitting there and he's getting all the homes and he's not doing anything. No. It is in his name. They call it mujtahid, who struggle. Don't think that coming up with the halal and haram is an easy task. No. They go through a struggle to make sure that they give you and I an Islamic ruling. Right? So we call it mujtahid. Mujtahid from the word juhud, jihad, struggle. Right? So any kind of struggle is called jihad in Islam. It's called jihad in Arabic. But in Islam, when we say al-jihad, today, unfortunately, the word jihad has been used for wrong purpose. The first thing we hear when we hear when the word jihad comes, the first thing it comes in our mind is guns, right? Attacking innocent people, we call that jihad. No. I'm going to let you understand, in Islam, there are so many jihad. So many jihad. Not one, not two, not three, right? The first one is called jihadul mal. That's why in Arabic or in Islam, when you say jihad, it doesn't mean anything until you add something to it. It's like when I say a food, what does it mean? It can be anything, right? It can be pizza. It can be biryani. It can be anything. It's called food, right? Now, the word jihad, it doesn't mean anything unless you attach it to something, right? The first one is called jihadul mal. Struggle with money. Which one is that? Giving and spending for the sake of Allah is called jihadul mal. That is one of the jihad Islam emphasized. Allah said in the Quran, وَجَاهِدُوا بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ. Do jihad with your money. Because it's a tough thing. Somebody work, they earn, and they give the money to somebody else. It's a jihad, it's a struggle, right? That is why when you come to Islam, the Prophet says, those who have done jihad in Islam to spread the word of Islam, one of them is Khadija alayhi salam. But what jihad did Khadija did? Not with the sword. Her jihad was by giving her money for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wealthiest woman among the in Arabia. And when the Prophet started his mission, she gave everything she has for the Prophet to use it for the sake of Allah. That is called what? Jihad al mal. Jihad of money. So jihad is not just the sword. Sometimes it could be money. That is one. Number two. And this is called for the sisters. That jihad is just for the sisters. And it's called jihad al mar'a. Jihad for women. And when did this jihad came in the picture? One of the ladies came to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, we know men go to the battlefield, they fight the enemies, and when they die, they call shaheed. Shaheed means what? Allah has granted them a heaven. No question. Because a shaheed, who died in the path of Allah, when they died, they're not getting washed. They're not getting kafan. They've been buried with the blood the way they died. Why? Because the secret is so yawm al-qiyamah, Allah feels shy to question them. Right? That's the jihad. So a woman came, she said, Ya Rasulullah, we women, we don't get to go to jihad. Because jihad, that jihad, fighting the enemy in the battlefield, is not wajib upon the women. You don't have to go. Right? But if a woman said, I want to go to jihad, right? And she get the permission from her husband, right? Or if she lives on her own and she wants to go, Islam says that's fine. But Islam doesn't make it wajib upon women. It's just on men. Now, this lady came to the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, these men, they get to go to jihad. They get to become shaheed. But we don't get to go, Ya Rasulullah. Can you tell me something we women can do so we can earn the same reward as the men go, as men when they go to jihad? The Prophet says, sure. Because in Islam, there's always discount. Right? There's always discount. If there is something you can't do it, Islam gives you another alternative. And gives you another option. So this woman, she wants discount. The Prophet says, no problem. What is the discount? It's a jihad of a woman, right? Jihadul mar'ati husnul taba'ul. Is to be good and kind to her husband. Allahu Akbar. What an easy man. Sometimes you feel like being a woman, right? Because I said, you'll be kind to your husband, that's it. Allah said, you get that joy. Can you get any easier than this? Huh? You take a glass of water, you give to your husband, that's your jihad. Allahu Akbar. Right? You cook for your husband, the Prophet said, that is your jihad. Allahu Akbar. You wash your husband's plate after he eat, is your jihad. Can it get any easier than that? That is considered the second jihad of a woman in Islam. Jihadul mar'ati husnul taba'ul. That is number two. Another second jihad. Number three, another jihad, which comes from the Prophet. It says, Afdalul jihad kalimatu haqqin inda sultanin jahir. The third one, jihad, is to speak the truth in front of a tyrant. Allahu Akbar. That's one of the jihad, huh? A jihad is not just to take a sword. No. One of the jihad, I see a tyrant, a person who doesn't fear Allah. I tell them the truth in their face. The Prophet said that is one of the jihad. And not just the jihad, it's the best jihad. Right? Give me one example. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salam. He was in the castle of Mansur. Right? He was sitting in Mansur. Mansur brought him by force. And he was sitting with Imam. And Imam, he asked Imam, he said, why don't you come to us? A lot of people want to come to us, sit with us, get food, get money, get everything. Look at the powerful word of Imam. Imam said to him, Ala manatik, why should I come to you? He says, what I wish about the akhirah, you don't have it. And what you have about dunya, I have zero desire in. Allahu Akbar. Right? While they were sitting, then a fly came and stood on the nose of Mansur. He wanted to kill it, the fly flew away. It came the second time. It tried to kill it, it flew away. The third time, he became so angry and he asked Imam Ja'far. He said, Yabna Rasulullah, why did Allah even create the fly? Now look at the answer of Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq. He said to him, I said, Ya Mansur, Allah created this fly to humiliate and disgrace tyrants like you. Allahu Akbar. You think you're something, but you can't even stand a fly? Right? Imam tells him, now Mansur became so angry. Why? Because he heard the truth, nobody could stand in front of him and tell him the truth. Right? That is one. Another one. Imam Zain al-Abidin, salamullah alayhi, kalimatu haq, telling the truth, which today we don't have it. Even in our gatherings today, Amr bil Ma'ruf is dead. Why? Because we have something we adopt here, we call it none of my business. Right? I see somebody is doing something wrong, I say, none of my business, why do I care? Right? That's what we say. Well, in Islam, when somebody is doing something wrong in front of you, it's your responsibility to say something. Now, Imam and the castle of Yazid, when everything was going on inside the castle, Imam said to Yazid, this is Kalima to Haq, telling the truth in front of the tyrant. He said to Yazid, allow me to go on this podium to say words that pleases Allah and the audience also benefit and they get the thawab. Because he didn't want to allow Imam. Because he knows what is gonna come out of Imam, it's not gonna be something you want to hear. People said, no, let him speak. We want to hear from him. Imam goes on the member, right? Imam goes on the member. He sat there. He started to say, أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ مَنْ عَرَفَنِي عَرَفَنِي وَمَنْ لَمْ يَعْرِفْنِي أُعَرِّفُهُ بِنَسَبِي وَحَسَبِي. He said, anybody who knows me, knows me. Who doesn't know me, I will introduce myself to you. Right? And Imam goes to the details. I am the son of Mustafa. I'm the son of Ali. I'm the son of Zahra. And he goes, I'm the son of Mecca and Mina and. Until Imam gets to the point where he says, Ana ibnul madbuhi bi Karbala. I'm the son of he who got slaughtered in Karbala. That's when people started crying. Screaming, right? Now, when Yazid saw that, he wanted to stop it. What did he say? He said to one of them, call Adhan to stop. Imam Zain al-Abidin. Right? The Adhan started. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Imam responded, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Imam responded, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. Now look at the kalimatu haq, telling the tyrant the truth in his castle. Imam Zain al-Abidin tells him, he said to him, Ya Yazid, a Muhammadun jaddi am jaddu. He said, Muhammad, that you just called in Adhan, is he your grandfather or my grandfather? And he said to him, and قُلْتَ جَدُّكْ فَقَدْ كَذَبْتَ وَكَفَرْ. If you say he's your grandfather, then you're a liar and you're a disbeliever. Right? And قُلْتَ جَدِّي, if you say he is my grandfather, then why did you kill my father Hussein in the land of Karbala? Right? The point is, كَلِمَةُ حَقْ, telling the truth in front of the tyrant. That is one form of jihad. That is one kind of jihad as well. That is number two. That's number three. Number four is called Jihadul Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Now listen careful to the wording of the Prophet. When did the good word came from? This word came from in hadith of the Prophet when the Prophet sent armies to go and fight. Right? When they came back, the Prophet received them. And he wants to welcome them. And he said, Marhaban biqawmin. Welcome to those who just came back from the smallest jihad. Now listen to the word. We have small and we have smallest. We have big and then we have great and greatest. Now the Prophet says, وَرَجَعُوا مِنَ الْجِهَادِ الْأَصْغَرِ وَبَقِيَ عَلَيْهِمْ جِهَادُ الْأَكْبَرِ. They came from the smallest jihad, and yet they have the biggest jihad to fight. And Allah, the Prophet used the word Akbar. Now you and I, in our salat, what do we call Allah? Allahu Akbar, meaning the greatest one, that there is no great thing that can be compared with. Right? That's what it means. Allahu Akbar. I am saying Allah is the greatest. Nothing can be compared to his greatness. That's what I mean, Allahu Akbar. Now, the same word the Prophet used. It says, they came back from the smallest jihad and they still have the biggest jihad to fight. Then the companions asked, Ya Rasulullah, what are you talking about? What jihad is the biggest jihad? The Prophet says, Jihadun Nafs. Fighting yourself internally. Right? The Prophet called that Jihadun Nafs. Allahu Akbar. Then he asked the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, are you comparing this jihad with nafs compared to the jihad with the enemy? And you call that smallest jihad and you call it this the biggest one? He said, yes, what? He said, listen to the wisdom. He said, the jihad al-asghar, which you fight the enemy in the battlefield. He said, that jihad either is 1 day or 2 days or a week or a month or 10 years. If you get killed, the battle is over. If you kill the enemy, the battle is over. Isn't that the case?
Yes, yes.
He said, but jihad in nafs, it starts from the time of bulugh till the time you die. When you're sleeping, the jihad is still on. Shaitan doesn't leave you.
Right? You are standing, the war is still on with the shaitan. You are sitting, you are laying. Every moment of your life, the jihad is still on. Sometimes you are sleeping, the bad dreams that you have, and still shaitan comes in your dream. Doesn't leave you alone.
That jihad is the biggest jihad. That is why the Prophet called it Jihadul Akbar, the biggest jihad.
Why?
Because that jihad is jihad that is life jihad. There is no time for it until the day you die.
Right? That is that jihad. Now you come to the other jihad, which is called Jihadul Asghar.
The Prophet called it the smallest one,
which is
to fight your enemies outside.
Which today, a lot of people, when they hear jihad, that is the only thing that comes in their mind. They forget jihad al-akbar. They forget jihad al-mar'ah. They forget jihad al-mal. They forget jihad amam al-zalim. They forget all of that. The only one that comes is to fight an enemy. And the Prophet calls that jihad the smallest one. Why?
Because that jihad is not that important in Islam. No.
Compared to the rest, that is the lowest. That's why the Prophet called it Jihadul Asghar, the smallest. Because now listen, when you compare all these jihad, right, the Prophet called that one the smallest one.
Allahu Akbar. Because in Islam, that is considered the less one. That is not as important. Because Islam wants you to take care of yourself first before you think about the others. When you get to the airplane, right, some of you have flew before. When they are doing the announcement, what do they say? They say, in case of emergency, put your own mask first and then assist in others. That's what they say. That's the logic, right?
Islam said, before I go and say that I'm going to find somebody to become a Muslim, to become obedient to Allah, Allah said, take care of yourself first. And why do I do that? I do that with the what? Jihadul Akbar first and then the second. Now, up to here, when will the jihad al-Asghar start? When do I have to be in the jihad that we're talking about, the less one, the smallest one? Number one, we have to understand fighting enemies on the battlefield cannot be considered a mandatory unless it comes one of the four. Anytime other than these four,
it's not considered jihad.
If a person dies in that,
he dies like any other ordinary death. He can call himself whatever he wants to call.
Number one, before a jihad fighting the enemy becomes acceptable, allowed in Islam, it has to be authorized by Allah first. Allah, if he tells you, go, you have an ayah in the Quran. Allah tells the Prophet, go and fight, that is becomes jihad. Right? Like he said to the Prophet after they went to Medina. In Surah Al-Tawbah, أُذِنَ لِلَّذِينَ يُقَاتَلُونَ بَعْدَمَا ظُلِمُوا Allah says that now I permitted the Muslim to defend. Now listen, one thing about jihad, we don't have in Islam going attack others. No, no, no. We have self-defense. That's what we have. The jihad that we have in Islam is when somebody attacks you, Islam says then defend yourself. But no jihad that says go and attack innocent people just because they're not Muslim. No, we don't have that in Islam. Right? So the first jihad that Allah authorized to the Prophet, and that was after he left Mecca to Medina, when the Muslims became a little stronger after they went through torture, they went through exile, they went through every kind of bad things, Allah said, now you have now settled in Medina. If they attack, you are allowed to defend yourself. Because when they were in Mecca, they are not allowed to actually, they are not even allowed to defend themselves. They killed so many of them in Mecca, and they were helpless. They couldn't say anything. Ammar ibn Yasir, his father, was killed, Yasir, his mother Sumayya were killed, nothing was done. The Prophet didn't repent, didn't say anything. Right? They were not allowed to fight, or to even defend themselves. Now, when they went to Medina, Allah told the Prophet, now self-defense is wajib upon you. Right? Now, in that situation,
then self-defense becomes wajib. Because Allah says so. That is number one. So the first one who can authorize for us to go and defend ourselves is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one. Number two. Or the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself. Like he did in the battle of Uhud. In the battle of Badr. When the Muslims knew that they are now being attacked, and the Prophet told the Muslims, you have to defend yourself. That is the second authorization we need before we are allowed to defend ourselves. That is number two. Number three, it has to come from what? From Imam. Masoom, I have to tell you, you are obligated to go and defend yourself. Like Imam Hussein alayhi salam. That is why we call those who got killed with Imam Hussein, shuhada. Because that battle, that self-defense was authorized by Imam Masoom. Right? That's number three. Number four is the na'ib of Imam, which is al-marja. Al-marja, which marja? Al-marja, al-jama' li-shara'it, which is met all the conditions. Not somebody who comes and says, oh, I'm a marja last night, right? He walk home, he was not a marja. He come back next morning, he's a marja. Allahu Akbar. He entered the house, he's not a marja. The next morning, he becomes marja. Now he gives fatwa, everything, do this, don't do it. That is not what we're talking about. Marja, that is met the conditions. Where? What is the conditions? The condition that was given by the 12th Imam. Right? What is the condition? Let me give you the condition. Number one, our 12th Imam gave us the condition when a person can be considered a marja and when a person can be considered a deputy of Imam. Number one, he said, man kana min al fuqaha. First, they have to become faqih. They studied enough where they know the rules of Allah, halal and haram enough. Right? Now, how do we know that? They have to be authorized by the scholar, and that's the system in housing. I can't go there, I study 6 years, 7 years, 10 years, and then come say, alhamdulillah, I'm now mujtahid, I'm marja. You want to do taqlid of me? Huh? Come on in. No, they have to be authorized by a scholar who taught them for years, and he evaluated them and their knowledge and knew they are reached to the level of mujtahid. That is number one. Is that enough? No. They can become mujtahid, but we might not be able to follow them. Because that's not the only condition. Number two, the Prophet, the Imam says, صَائِنًا لِنَفْسِهِ. He has to become a person who protects himself. How? In everything that he lives in. In everything, he has to protect himself. Meaning, he doesn't go to a places where he's not supposed to be seen. That's one. Tomorrow, if you see a marja, God forbid, he is running around at the nightclub. Huh? MashaAllah, what are you doing with your chairman in the nightclub? No, I'm just hanging around here. Oh, is it what we're going to follow him? No. He should not be seen places he's not supposed to be seen. He has to protect himself, right? Even his dress, the way he dressed, he has to protect himself, right? You can see a marja walking on the street with the sweatpants, right? You're a marja, but with the sweatpants? No. Right? He has to carry himself in the way a marja is supposed to. That is number two. Number three. حَافِظًا لِدِينِهِ. He has to be a person who protects the religion of Allah. When somebody attacks Islam with suspicions, with questions, he should be able to answer. That's their job. Because that's the job of Imam. All the Imams, no question ever been thrown at them unless they answer. If you become the na'ib of Imam, you have to answer the questions. That's number three. Number four, right? مُخَالِفًا لِهَوَى. He goes against his own evil desires. Meaning, good servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Practicing person. Right? Number five, Imam says, also مُطِيعًا لِأَمْرِ مَوْلَى. He also obeys the master's order, which Imam of his time. Right? If he meets these conditions, then he is qualified to become a mujtahid, a marja. Now in that situation, if he comes and says, this battle is wajib or is jihad, then we are allowed to listen to him at that point. Why? Because he missed the condition. Right? Now in that situation, If the person that comes and tells us, go and do jihad, it's not authorized by Allah, it's not authorized by the Prophet, not authorized by Imam, not even a marja, guess what? We say, thank you for the announcement, but we take your announcement, we put under our shoe, and we step on it. So we're not going anywhere. Why? And if you say, I'm going to go, and you get killed, Allahu Akbar, guess what? You will be going to Jahannam. I'm telling you, and take this as my word. If a person get killed and sometimes somebody called them for jihad and they die in that, it's called what? It's called a kafir. Why? Because your soul is not supposed to be sold or killed in anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why in Surah Al-Tawbah Allah said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Right? So that is one of the jihad as well. Right? Now, another jihad is there too in Islam. And jihad is when you struggle to defend your family and defend your property. It's called jihad. And that's why if a person got killed and struggling to defend his wife or to defend his children or to defend his parent or defend his own property, then the person will be called shaheed as well. Right? That is the condition of jihad. So when we hear the word jihad, brothers and sisters, it's not just to go, just to take a gun and go and fight someone. No. And even with that, as we mentioned, if it's authorized by one of these four, there is conditions on that. Right? It's not like what you hear or you see on the TV. Wallah, that has nothing to do with Islam. Right? Because when as prophet or imam or mujtahid calls for jihad, there are rules and regulation on that jihad. It's not a blank check. I'll give you some of them. Number one, when we go to jihad, the Prophet told Imam Ali, when he was sending him to jihad, he said, number one, Ya Ali, when you go to fight people, first, he said, do not chase anybody who running away from the battle. Allahu Akbar. Wallah, Islam is beautiful. Somebody running? He said, they wouldn't declare defeat. So don't just let them go. That is one. Number two, when you go to the battlefield, you are not allowed to fight an older man. Allahu Akbar. Older people, you're not allowed to fight them or kill them. No. That is two. Number three, you're not allowed to fight children and infants. It's haram in Islam. Right? That is number three. Number four, you're not allowed to fight and kill women. Allahu Akbar. These are all things in Islam. When you go to jihad, that is authorized by one of the four we mentioned. You have to observe all of this. Not only that, the Prophet said to Ali, when you go to fight the jihad, I said, you are not allowed to cut a tree unless it's on your way. Now you understand, cutting, beheading people's head for no reason, it doesn't make sense in the Islam that Prophet brought, because even the Prophet said, don't cut a tree for no reason on your way. When you cut the tree, it should be a reason for you, Ya Rasulullah. Ya Ali, the Prophet says. Not only that, when you go to the battlefield, one of the rules is that you are not allowed, right? If you capture the prisoner, you are not allowed to disgrace or disrespect them just because they're prisoners. No. You have to respect them, right? And you want to know how Ahlul Bayt they treat the prisoners? Look at how Imam Ali was treating Abdurrahman ibn Muljam al-Murad. Abdurrahman ibn Muljam. Right? What did he tell Imam Ali? What Imam Ali told his children? He says, Ya Hassan, Ya Hussein, he's your prisoner, it's my prisoner. But he said, make sure he eats whatever you eat. Make sure that he's comfortable. Make sure that he has not been disrespectful. That is how we treat prisoners. What? That is one of the Islamic teachings. What? Not only that, Islam teaches when you go to the battlefield and you capture an enemy, right? A person you fight, I said, you are not allowed to deceive them in anything. No. You are not allowed to use something against them. Allahu Akbar. You remember in the Battle of Siffin? Imam Ali and Muawiyah, just a river. Water, Muawiyah was in control, and later on Muawiyah was using it against Imam Ali alayhi salam. So that way he can weaken Imam Ali's soldiers. The time of Salat comes, Imam Ali wants to pray, no, you can't use the water. People want to drink the water? No, Muawiyah said, we are not going to let you. Right? Imam Ali alayhi salam, he organized his armies, they attacked, they took the water, they got the water, they drank, they made wudu, they prayed. One of the companions of Imam Ali said to him, Ya Ali, linamna'ahum kama sana'u bina. Let's prevent them from the water as they did to us. You know what Imam Ali said? He said, no, we are not going to do that. Imam Ali, we just fought them, took control of the water. Why don't we do the same thing? Imam Ali said, no. And he said to him, I said, this is a style of a weak ones. You want to use something against the enemy? He said, no. We will leave the water is between us. They drink, we drink. They use it, we use it. If they defeat us, fine. If we defeat them, that's fine. We will fight them as men. And we are not going to use water to be the way of defeat. That is the teaching of Islam. That when you fight your enemy, you are not allowed to fight them and use certain things like this in order to defeat them. No. Right? Another one. Islam says you are not allowed to go and fight the enemy just because they are not Muslims. No. Look in the history of Islam. Where did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam ever force Christians or Jews or atheists or whatsoever to become Muslims by force? No. As a matter of fact, it's what opposite. Right? Today we hear in Iraq, when they take a small city, every Christian, either you have to take your cross off and start wearing the veil and become a Muslim, or we're going to kill you. That was not in Islamic teaching. Nowhere in Islam. Right? As a matter of fact, the Prophet in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah told him, right? When a man came to the Prophet and his name is Abu al-Hasin, he was a Christian, he accepted Islam, but he has two sons. They were not Muslims. They were Christians. Not only they were Christians, they decided to become missionaries. Even though their father is a Muslim, right? Some missionaries came from Sham to Mecca. They followed them to go and spread the Christianity. The father, Abu al-Hasin, he was hurt. He came to the Prophet. Ya Rasulullah, I have two children. I accepted Islam. I'm a Muslim. And it hurts me that my two sons are not Muslims. Ya Rasulullah, can I force them to become Muslims? Right? That was his question. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent text message. Ya Rasulullah, Jibreel, get to the Muhammad. What is it? The ayah you read in Surah Al-Baqarah after Ayat Al-Kursi. لا إكراه في الدين قد تبين الرشد من البين فمن يكفر بالطاغوت ويؤمن بالله فقد استمسك بالعروة الوثقى. Allah told the Prophet, Ya Rasulullah, tell this man, Abu Hasin, لا إكراه في الدين, cannot force your child just because you're Muslim to force them against their will to become Muslim. No. Why? Allah said, قد تبين الرشد من الغيب. Because Islam is a more religion of wisdom than it's a religion of sword and force. Why? Because any religion that has put people in there by force, they will come out by force too. And it's not beneficial. But if somebody accepted Islam with wisdom, they stay and they stick in that religion. And that's what the Islam is saying. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah told him, you cannot force anybody to become a Muslim. No. Leave them what they want. Another one in Surah and Quran, Allah told the Prophet, when the kafirun, the disbelievers, they came to the Prophet, قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الْكَافِرُونَ لَا أَعْبُدُ مَا تَعْبُدُونَ. Right? At the end, he said, لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَدُونَ. You practice your religion, and let me practice my religion. There was no sword the Prophet ever left on someone to make them by force to become Muslim. No, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the Quran also, through Allah, he said, أُدْعُ إِلَىٰ سَبِيلِ رَبِّكَ بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْحِدَةِ الْحَسَنِ. Islam is a religion of wisdom, the religion of logic, the religion of understanding, not the religion of force. So when we talk about jihad, jihad is not about anything like that we understood today. Jihad is more about what? About self-defense, which is all, which also is what? It collaborate with the mind as well. Because even in animal world, when you attack tiger, right? Does the tiger turn and give you candy? Huh? If you attack an animal, the animal turn and say, okay, you attack him, I'm gonna give you candy so you can leave me alone. They attack back because it's a common sense. So Islam is also telling you, when somebody attacks you, you are allowed to defend yourself. And that defense is what is called jihad. Not to take the sword and attack innocent people, killing innocent women, killing innocent children in the name of jihad. That is not jihad in Islam. Right? And that is why you go on the day of Ashura, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, after he was killed and all the companions, the enemies of Ali al-Bayt alayhi salam, they said, "Ihriqu buyut al-zalimin." He said, "Burn the houses of tyrant." And they were calling Imam Hussein a tyrant. Now what happened? Hamid ibn Muslim, one of the narrators, he said, "I was there when I was observing the whole thing." He says, when they started to burn the tent of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, I saw a little girl who came running out of the tent. And she was running from one tent to another, looking for shelter. No father to shelter her, no uncle to shelter her. He says, as she entered in one of the tent, when she came out, I saw her dress catches fire. He said, I started chasing her to try to set off the fire. He said, as the longer I chase her, the longer she runs, because she thought I'm one of the enemies. She ran and ran and got tired, and she stood and turned. And she said to me, Hamid ibn Muslim, she said to me, Ya Rajul al-anta lana am alayna. He said, are you with us or you are against us? Are you an enemy or a friend? Hamid says, I'm not a friend or enemy. I just saw a fire on your dress. I wanted to set it off. She allows him to set off the fire. Then he said, Ya Shaykh al-indaka ma, do you have a water? He said, I don't have water, but I can take you somewhere where you can get water. He took her to the river. He said, drink the water. She stood in front of the water. She would not drink. Hamid said, I was standing watching her. I told her, drink. She wouldn't drink. And then she turned and looked at Hamid ibn Muslim. And she said, Ya Shaykh, Ashrab waqad kutila abi al-Husayn matsha. Why should I drink when I saw my father who has been killed next to the river and he was not being given the water? Why should I drink water? He then she then refused to drink water. Hamid ibn Muslim said, she stood there and she cried and she turned towards me and she said, Ya Sheikh, Hal qara'ta al-Quran? Have you read Quran in your life? He said, yes, I did. And then she said, did you ever heard where Allah said, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ. Do not be harsh with the orphan. He said, yes, I read this surah before. Then she said to him, Ya Shaykh, أَنَا يَتِيمُ أَبَا عَبْدِ اللَّهِ الْحُسَيْنِ. She said, I'm the orphan of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. I'm the orphan that he left behind. The Shaykh said, Hamid ibn Muslim, he said, I didn't hold myself before I realized the tears was just running on my face. Then she said to me, Ya Shaykh, al ta'rif tariqa Karbala? Do you know the tariqa, the way of Najaf? He said, yes, I know where Najaf is. I can show you the way to Najaf. But let me ask you, why do you want to go to Najaf? She said, I heard we have a shrine there where my grandfather Imam Ali was buried. I want to go there and complain to him how we were treated. I want to go and complain to my grandfather how they killed my father Hussein without a water. I want to go and complain to my grandfather how we were treated after him. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيَّ مُنْقَلَبٍ يَنْقَلِبُونَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. يا حسين يا حسين يا